Hey everyone, welcome to another edition of the Fandor Video Podcast. I'm Hooman. I'm here with my co-host, Chris Kelly.
Thank you so much, Hoop.
And
it's great to see you as always.
Oh, and of course.
Reunited, and it feels so good.
Welcome, Brent.
Thanks, man.
All right. So this interview is brought to us by the Sonoma International Film Festival because they're presenting their summer fest August 4th to 6th. They're gonna have outdoor screenings at wineries, indoor screenings. And they're going to have food trucks. There's going to be a four-course dinner paired at the Jackson Family Wine Estates. And the culinary event is going to feature a documentary by a woman named Rebecca Halpern. Love Charlie, The Rise and Fall of Charlie Trotter. It's going to be Saturday, August 6th. And you can get all the tickets from SonomaFilmFest.org. Here we are.
Ta-da!
With Rebecca. Welcome, Rebecca.
Thanks. It's so good to be here, you guys.
Normally I ask a director, you know, tell us what your film's about, but I don't want to start with that today. I want to start with your background because you're a seasoned veteran. Tell us how you paid your dues to get to this point.
Well, I got my start like many in Hollywood in the William Morris mailroom. I delivered packages for them for a while and worked my way up to becoming TV talent coordinator role, which is like a step below agent. And tucked in there after that was a spell with Michael Ovitz, which is a whole other story for another time. I'm not sure if the NDA they made me sign when I went to work for him is still in effect, so I don't think I can share much about that. But then I decided that rather than be an agent, I wanted to have an agent. There was something about the role that didn't feel creative enough for me. It didn't exercise enough of my curiosity in the world that, you know, it's a great job and I think it's an important one in the industry, but it wasn't for me. So I went back to graduate school and got my master's degree in broadcast journalism and magazine publishing. And from there, I went into local news. And then one thing led to another. And this is an interesting story. I was working in Phoenix for the CNN affiliate in Phoenix. And my dad was sick in Chicago and I wanted to move back. So I was offered two jobs. One was as the field producer slash sometimes correspondent for CNN's Kabul, Afghanistan bureau.
Not close to Chicago.
No. And this was in 2008. Okay. So this was at a time that was pretty heightened over there. And then the other job I was offered was an episode of a series, a documentary series for Animal Planet called Animal Witness. And it was about animals that witness crimes and help police solve the cases.
Oh, yes.
Oh, wow. And my episode that they were offering me was about a cockatoo that witnessed its owner's murder and helped police solve the crime.
Wow.
And I thought to myself, okay, I don't want to give my dad, my poor sick dad, anything else to worry about. So I took the bird show and it was a half hour episode. I had never done anything that long before. And we shot like heavy reenactments for that. And I remember driving up to the set and there were trucks, you know, grip trucks and all kinds of stuff parked on the street. And I said to my location scout, I said, you know, wow, they must be shooting a real movie here. And she goes, no, that's for you. Just like, what? So I faked it till I made it and have been faking it ever since and making it, I guess.
Hold on. Fantastic. Listen, we can't even talk about Charlie Trotter without talking about the cockatoo. So what happened in the episode? Like,
okay.
Polly watch a murder or?
Yeah, exactly. It was actually called Life Animal Witness, Life, Limb, and Feather. And the bird witnessed its owner being stabbed. It flew to his defense and pecked the killer's head while he was stabbing the guy.
So was the killer DNA? Killer DNA? And
yeah, so the killer wiped his head and wiped the wall on his way out, and that's how they got the DNA. But he also slashed the bird, killed the bird, wow. Chopped off the bird's leg. It was very heroic and sad the way it went down, but That is, you know, that's the kind of bird I want to have one day.
You, I mean, this might seem silly, but you win an Emmy or anything for this?
Oh, sound... God, no. And when I look back on it now, I'm just mortified. That, you know, I mean, listen, it was a great learning experience.
It's an incredible story.
It was 15 years ago. So, you know, back then, true crime documentaries were about as frothy as they come. And, you know, these days, I'm pleased to say that, you know, my level of sophistication has grown since then. So luckily for me, but that was a great experience. It really
That's
was.
That's a great story. I almost feel like we should just keep talking about the bird, but I yeah, I guess we got to talk about
the
movie.
Let's get to the movie.
So tell us about your film, Love Charlie, The Rise and Fall of Charlie Trotter. Like, what's it about? And like, how long did it take from the time you started researching it to complete shooting? Give us the whole story there.
Yeah. So, you know, every city has its claim to fame, right? You know, in New York, it's Broadway and Wall Street. In LA, it's Hollywood. And in Chicago, it's food for the most part. And Charlie Trotter was the chef who put Chicago on the map for food. His groundbreaking style of cuisine and all the different things he innovated really changed the face of fine dining in America. He was an entirely self-taught chef. And when he opened his restaurant in 1987, he really hadn't even been like the top dog anywhere before he did it. So he was truly a wunderkind. He ran his restaurant for 25 years. Every night he served two 10-course tasting menus, and he never served the same dish twice.
Wow.
So every night it was 20 different courses every night. And in the film, one of the chefs says, you know, he'd like have to like walk into the fridge and be like, I've got a, you know, potato, some trout, a red pepper, go. And he'd have to make like seven courses out of
Iron
that.
Chef every night.
Every night. Exactly. Iron Chef every night. And he opened his restaurant in 1987. Closed it in 2012, and his entire life's work was geared towards winning three Michelin stars, which for those who don't know is sort of like the Oscars of the food world. And he, throughout his career, had people working for him who loved him, and he had people working for him who didn't love him. And one of those people who I think now respects him is a chef named Grant Achatz, who owns Alinea in Chicago, which is also a very well-known restaurant. Anyway, he opened Alinea in year 23 of Charlie Trotter's. He won three stars. Charlie only won two. And the same thing happened the next year. And Charlie was sick by then. He, I don't want to ruin it for anyone, but he had an inoperable brain aneurysm, and it was changing his behavior. The quality of the work wasn't as good as it once was. And in year 25, he decided to close, and he died a year later.
Wow. What was the most difficult thing about making this movie? Was there one thing in particular?
Well, we started production on day one of the COVID lockdown.
Oh, boy.
Yes.
There we go.
So there you have it. And so we really had to innovate and come up with not only new ways of shooting our interviews, but we also had to come up with, we had to really rejigger some of the production plans for the show, or for the film. There's a farm in Ohio that Charlie was really close with the farmer there, Farmer Lee Jones, and it's called the Chef's Garden. And we had this grand plan to have everyone who worked for Charlie kind of gather for this big farm to table dinner, because one of the things that Charlie revolutionized in America was vegetarianism and that kind of farm to table dining. And we had to scrap that because obviously you can't get 40 people together or 50 people together. The supply chains for food were kind of dicey back then. And, you know, there was just a lot going on. So luckily, we had about 1,000 postcards that Charlie had written to his friends and family. And we were able to animate those and use those as kind of the basis of the storytelling. So that's how we managed to survive.
That almost sounds like a better direction. It seems like the pandemic gave you a wiser idea than what you guys probably originally thought of, because you had to be a lot more creative. I want to ask you something. I want you to talk about Charlie's level of commitment, and then I want you to talk about Charlie's identity.
Yeah. So a lot of people used to think Charlie was a perfectionist, and I don't think that's right. I think Charlie would have said that he was a perfectionism is boring. Charlie was an excellencist. And when you think about the difference between the two, perfectionism is about the outcome. Excellence is about the process. And Charlie, you know, really poured his heart and soul into everything he did, 1,000,000%. Some people call that love, right? Love Charlie. And some people call that dedication, obsession, call it what you will, but it's at the end of the day, that kind of care is something that he was really keyed into. And he took it to an almost nth degree. And in the process of becoming so sort of wrapped up in this pursuit of excellence, he lost a sense of himself. Mm-hmm. You know, when your identity becomes so tied up in your work, you know, there's lots of casualties around you. Family relationships get strained, friendships get strained. You start to act in ways that maybe the general public won't understand. And so you become misunderstood, mischaracterized. And at the end of the day, when Charlie got sick and closed his restaurant, it was as if he had lost himself by the end. And that's why a year later, almost like cinematically, he died, because it was like he couldn't get back to his old former self. And we illustrate that arc. We illustrate that arc very clearly in the film. So it's pretty compelling, you know. And going back to the whole pandemic thing, I'll tell you, the nostalgia factor for the 80s and 90s is really strong with our movie. The postcards, mixtapes, collages, all the sort of tangible archival materials that we have really take us back to a time when it took a lot of effort to connect with other people. And when I think about what Charlie,
I'll go ahead, please.
Well, I was just going to say, when you think about what Charlie did every day, that was a kind of care and connection that I don't think a lot of people appreciate nowadays.
I really like that you just talked about nostalgia, because there have been so many articles written about the new Top Gun, Maverick. Mm-hmm. And so often they're saying it's taking us back to a time that was less stressful, where we weren't so divided. So I think this whole idea of taking people back to the, I think it's going to be really
be very, very appealing.
Compelling. Yeah. Let's talk about, since we brought up Top Gun. I've heard, you know, I stalked you before we did this interview. I listened to what you said. I'm just going to mention a film, and I just love to hear your thoughts on it. Jiro Dreams of Sushi. What do you think of that movie?
I mean, it's a meditation on, it's just a meditation in general, right? And it's also a meditation on excellence. And I think that what, it's David Gelb, right? Who is the filmmaker on Jiro? Yeah. If I'm misspeaking, forgive me. But, you know, I think he introduced a whole new genre of food media, food content that you now see in Chef's Table, which he's a part of, actually. And you see it in the way a lot of food documentaries are shot these days. And it's really beautiful. You know, in terms of the concept of Jiro, Dreams of Sushi, Malcolm Gladwell says it takes 10,000 hours to perfect a thing. And when you think about how much time he spent making the rice, slicing the salmon, whatever it is that he does, you know, that highly specialized skill set that is so valued over there, it's really interesting. I mean, I woke up at 5:30 every morning during the lockdown and worked until 10:30 at night. And thank God for that, because it was my lifeline during the pandemic. I mean, you know, I was in the flow, in the zone. And I think that that's what Jiro, to me, that's what it spoke to.
Well, I have a huge surprise for you, Rebecca. We have the producer of Jiro Dreams of Sushi on with us now. Welcome, Chris Kelly.
I produced the movie with Kevin Yamashina and a couple other folks. And, you know, David's brilliance shone through, and it's so great to hear you describe it exactly the way that I think he would. I think it was also a meditation on family too, in an interesting way. But the thought of it, and it's had an incredible influence. I mean, I work at a Silicon Valley in venture and investing, and it became a huge thing in the venture community too, as a meditation on excellence and excellence in entrepreneurialism too.
How was her review of your movie? Does she know
absolutely.
What she's talking about?
This means that David did a brilliant job and that we didn't screw it up for him. So,
well, and you know, it's funny because like when people comment on my film, you know, if they pick up on the themes that I was going for in it, then I feel like I've done my job. And if it makes them look at their own lives a little differently, like I used to play competitive golf. I had my tour card for a spell. You know, I understand what it means to get in the zone and, you know, to practice something until it's perfect. And Charlie was not a perfect person. You know, he had a lot of people in his life who didn't like his approach to management. One of his managerial ideas was this notion that he shouldn't necessarily be paying you to practice your skill set. That if you can't get your job done in a certain period of time and you have to come in earlier in order to perfect that skill, so be it. And to be honest, I think that's a generational thing, but it's one that I relate to myself, because if you want to get better for you, you're going to do whatever it takes, whether you're getting paid to do it or not.
Yeah, no, that's great. I just thought that would be funny. You know, Chris is right here and you love that movie. I heard you reference it in other interviews. I'm like, oh, let's talk about
Chris, you'll have to tell me how you got involved with that.
I will.
You want to tell it right now?
I mean, look, it was Kevin and I met through common friends, and he was, David had been a student at USC film school and was just sort of getting, you know, his kind of sea legs in Hollywood. Kevin and I had met at Sundance and talked some things, and he gave me a DVD of some of the early cuts. And I said, oh, this is pretty interesting. And, you know, and sort of glommed on helped out both financially, invested in the film, and met David and helped put it together for the, and we eventually kind of put it together for Tribeca. David and Brandon, his editor, did a fantastic cut to get it into Tribeca, and then, you know, refined it a little bit more, and it just really came together brilliantly in the end.
Yeah, we had a wonderful executive producer who was similar to you. He had ties to Charlie previously. And I think it's a wonderful process to be a part of and to see how a film comes together. There are so many things that you don't think about when you're making a film. And I think to see that is really, it must have been very interesting for you, yeah, Chris.
It was a wonderful, wonderful process. And you know, one of my early experiences in film, I come out of the technology industry, and you know, it's in some ways it's made everything else, you know, kind of second rate. but it was great to take part in, and Kevin and I still work together on things. So.
Well, I think there's like nothing like getting that first cut when you haven't seen anything, you've just heard, been a part of the production process, but when you see it in that first iteration, there's almost something breathtaking about seeing all that hard work kind of come to fruition that way. It's really nice.
Yeah. All right, well, let's end with this, Rebecca. So you never met Charlie, and let's just say we had a special time machine and we could get you in front of him, and there you are, you jump out of the time machine, he's alone in his apartment, he's bored one night, and you say, Charlie, I'm a filmmaker. I'm going to be making a movie about you, and it's going to come out in 2022. And let's just say the year that you approach Charlie is around 2000 or 2005. What one or two questions would you want to ask Charlie?
Well, the first question I would ask him is, what would you like to see in your own movie? How would you like to be represented? I know those were two questions, but I think that's a really interesting thing, because I really struggled with that in the film because of these two camps, the love and the hate for Charlie. I really wanted to take a very careful approach to showing him in his entirety, warts and all, and in an unapologetic way while still inspiring people for what he created. So that's one question I would ask. And then the other question, touching on our identity conversation earlier, Charlie has an interesting quote that was one of his favorite quotes, which was, after love, there's only cuisine. And he used to sign his menus with that. And looking back on his life now, there's something so sad about that as it relates to his career, all the things he lost or was unable to bring to fruition in his own personal life because of that. And I would just want to get his take on how he feels about that quote now, looking back.
Ah, that's great. Wow. Well, her name is Rebecca Halpern. Her film is Love Charlie, The Rise and Fall of Charlie Trotter. It's going to be at the Sonoma Film Festival Saturday, August 6th at 6 p.m. You can get tickets and passes at sonomafilmfest.org. Rebecca, thank you so much.
You guys, this was a wonderful conversation. Thank you so much.
Of course.